When you eat French fries, are you helping to save the planet? All right, a little bit of a stretch, but follow me here. The oil that is used to make French fries is becoming sustainable aviation fuel that can help you fly around the world in a much more eco-friendly way. And that is just the beginning of the future of aviation fuel. I learned about it from Leigh Abrams at Honeywell. Leigh, what is sustainable jet fuel and why is this an important thing to talk about?
So sustainable jet fuel is a fuel that looks pretty much like the jet fuel we use today. The big difference is what it's made from. So instead of making this from fossil sources of energy, we're now taking things like waste oils, say used French fry oil, or crop oils, things like soybean and corn oil, and converting them into fuels that look and perform like the fuels that we're used to using every day.
And this is important, I imagine, because air travel is a big consumer of fuel. And so if we can solve that problem, we're making some real headway in creating a more sustainable future. Is that right?
That's right. I think aviation today is accountable for about 3.5% of global greenhouse gas emissions. So there's absolutely a big part for aviation to play in reducing those emissions through things like the use of sustainable aviation fuel.
I've read that sustainable aviation fuel is really hard to make. Why is that?
It is hard in some cases to find the right feedstocks to make it from, right? Because you want these to be things that aren't going to lead to deforestation, land degradation. You want them to truly be sustainable feedstocks. So once you find those, the process to turn them into a fuel is actually a lot of the things that we as Honeywell, a technology developer, already know how to do. We know how to take the oxygen out of things like that used French fry oil and make it into a fuel that performs much better in an engine.
If I get on a plane today, what are the chances that the fuel that is in that plane is sustainable?
If you are flying out of LAX, the chances are pretty good. One of our first customers who's using our technology to make sustainable aviation fuel today is World Energy, and they supply LAX with that sustainable aviation fuel. Beyond a select number of airports in the US and Europe, there's not a whole lot in use today. And so that's something that we're really all trying to work to change.
So why is that? Because what you're telling me is really exciting. The technology exists, the know-how exists. So why isn't this everywhere yet?
First of all, I think it's the incentives and kind of motivations of different folks to really start adopting sustainable technologies. The good news, I think, is that while this technology takes a little bit of time to, you know, develop a design and to actually build those plants and get them operating, there are already dozens of facilities in the planning and construction stages today. So you're going to see a lot more sustainable aviation fuel become available in the next several years. But you also see governments really trying to stand up this industry as well. In the US, the Inflation Reduction Act has done a lot to really enable this to continue to grow. One of the ways that it's done that is through a specific credit that is for every gallon of sustainable aviation fuel produced. In Europe, instead of using credits, they tend to use mandates. And there are mandates starting in 2025, even, for the use of sustainable aviation fuel in the EU. In 2030, that starts to include regulations for e-fuel, or fuel that is made from CO2 and renewable energy.
Leigh, can you just help me imagine how the French fry oil at the local fast food place actually travels somewhere and then becomes the fuel that gets me from New York to LA? How is that happening?
So we have a technology that converts that French fry oil into a blending component that you would then typically blend with some fossil jet. That's because of the current regulatory environment. And then that goes directly to an airport and gets uplifted into a plane. It's really not that many steps. Now, if you look at a different feedstock, for example, if you look at our recently announced e-fining technology, that's one that goes directly from CO2 to jet fuel, enabled by our methanol to jet technology. So you may have a couple of steps there where you first of all have a facility that converts CO2 into methanol. Methanol is great because you can ship it anywhere. And that means that when you're converting that CO2 into methanol, you can use renewable energy that is really the lowest cost, most efficient renewable energy that you can find out there. And then once you have methanol, which is an intermediate that's easily shipped and transported that we have supply chains for already, then that can be converted into sustainable aviation fuel, which has higher value overall.
Are there any projections for what the future looks like here, how quickly this gets adopted, and how much it can save in fossil fuel?
When we start looking at how do we develop a better technology, we're thinking about efficiency. We're thinking about how much energy does it use to make the fuel? How much fuel can we make out of a given feedstock? The more fuel you can make with the less energy, the better it is overall. Our eco-fining technology, for example, that's the one that converts French fry oil, is something that can give you a 65 to 80% reduction in carbon intensity versus conventional jet fuel. And that's something that you can use in the existing infrastructure for fueling and flying today. You don't need a new type of airplane. So that's really important as well, because it means it costs less overall to be more sustainable.
That's pretty incredible. Can I just double click on that for a second to make sure I understand? So when you're saying that you don't need any kind of new infrastructure, you're saying that this fuel can just feed directly into the existing planes and engines that we already have?
That's right. Now, there are some guidelines, of course, for how to do that and how to do that safely. And it depends on the feedstock that you're making the fuel from and the properties of that. But there's an organization that kind of regulates those fuels and makes sure that they look and feel and mix well with existing petroleum jet fuel.
Leigh, I think that this subject is going to sound really exciting to a lot of entrepreneurs who, of course, are thrilled by the idea that their air travel is going to become more sustainable. But, you know, most of us don't own private jets, so we aren't really in the position to be purchasing sustainable jet fuel. So how can entrepreneurs feel like they have some control or ability to contribute to this movement?
So there are various airlines who are developing mechanisms for their passengers to be able to select the type of fuel they want to fly on. DHL and FedEx, I believe, have committed to 30% of their transport by 2030 will be on SAF. And that's a pretty substantial commitment in terms of really enabling this industry to mature.
Well, Leigh, thank you for the work that you and the Honeywell team are doing to help make aviation travel more sustainable. And I really love the idea that my next French fry could be bathed in oil that helps me get across the country.
Thank you very much for having me.